Human evil, arguably, is the most common form of evil practiced in the world today. One need only look at the 20th century, the bloodiest century on record, with unprecedented levels of humans persecuting and murdering other human beings, to underscore that statement. Human evil comes from our abuse of our free will. And that abuse of our free will comes in two forms: sins of omission or sins of commission. Remember the penitential rite in Mass, where in confessing our sins to God and to the people around us, and by the way, that's no substitution for the sacrament of confession, we confess those things that we did or those things that we failed to do. Sins of omission are those things that we failed to do to prevent harm from coming to another person. So suppose I'm an auto mechanic, and I am lazy in my work or negligent in my work, and something happens to the car which leads to the injury or death of the people in it. That is a sin of omission. Suppose I give somebody false information that leads them to harm, bad legal advice that leads to their state of being degraded, bad medical advice that leads to them making a wrong judgment about their health, which leads to further illness and perhaps even death. Those two are examples of sins of omission. Sins of commission are what we normally think of when we talk about human evil. Those things that we do to bring harm to other human beings. Murder, lying, cheating, different forms of infidelity, things that bring about a degradation of human life, the destruction of human life. Now, why do human beings abuse their freedom? What motivates them to abuse their freedom and bring harm to other human beings? Well, in theology, we commonly have two sources. The first is idolatry. Idolatry is when we replace God with anything else, a false god. And when we do so, our drive to pursue that false god, whether it's money, whether it's power, it could be a distortion of good things, the pursuit of happiness taken to an extreme, the pursuit of love taken to an extreme, the pursuit of good health taken to an extreme. Those things, when pushed to extremes, can harm other human beings. So my quest for money and power leads to greed, and basically human beings are used, exploited as means to an end, and then disposed of if we no longer we no longer need them. Our quest for love at all costs could lead to serial forms of monogamy. We have a relationship with someone, we find that they do not meet our own needs alone, and then we toss them aside, and then have another relationship, same thing happens, we toss them aside, instead of working sensitively through negotiating the complexities of human beings. But if you focus your gaze on God, what God does is He teaches us the right way to go about life. And in going about life that is a virtuous way, a way that is good, a way that is right, the things that we do to pursue the good ends of life will involve us taking care to treat human beings well. So I want to build a business. If I have my gaze fixed on God, it is incumbent upon me to treat human beings well, because they are made in God's image and likeness, and they're helping me achieve my success, and therefore should have a share in the rewards. If I am in the pursuit of political office, it's not power for its own sake, but power to serve and better the lives of the people who will put me in that office. In the pursuit of love, instead of pursuing love for its own sake, what I'm doing is I'm pursuing a relationship of fidelity. And as I make my way through life and meet people, I can develop friendships. And perhaps one of those friendships can develop into something deeper, a relationship of love that is sealed through marriage. So looking at God first enables us to order human relations well. order human relations well so that we can achieve those good ends in life for ourselves, because in doing so, we are serving God and neighbor. Okay, so idolatry is the first source of this human abuse of freedom. The second is pride, or what Latin American theologians like to call egoismo, or egotism. Now, when we talk about pride or egotism, we are not talking about legitimate pride, such as having pride in your work. The deep down satisfaction of knowing that you did the right thing, that you're doing good things, a job well done, living a virtuous life. No. What we mean by pride, or egoismo, egotism, is where you put yourself in the center to the exclusion of the needs of others. It's basically self-idolatry. So when you look to yourself first to the exclusion of others, then others are liable to get injured, run over, harmed, because you're just looking out for yourself. Look out for number one, instead of putting yourself second to the needs of others, which does not mean that you do not achieve your goals in life. It means that achieving your goals in life is done in the company of others. Others who can help you achieve your goals while you help others achieve their goals. It is a mutual flourishing that happens, which this denies. Now, why does God allow for human evil? Why does God tolerate? Well, he doesn't tolerate it. Why does God allow for human evil? Well, look at the alternative. Suppose God took away our freedom. Suppose God micromanaged us. Suppose God made us into robots, programming us to do good all the time. Is that a relationship of love? No. God risks our abuse of free will. Why? Because to take away our free will is not love. To put it another way, God gave us free will because he loves us. He wants us to love him freely. He wants us to choose to love him. And he wants us to choose to be good. Not because of rewards or punishments, but because we want to be good for its own sake. For the sake of God. For the sake of his kingdom. For the sake of our neighbor. This is not about punishment and reward ultimately, although punishment and reward are part and parcel of developing as a human person. A fully mature human person, a fully mature Christian human person, avoids evil and embraces the good for the sake of embracing the good. Why? Because we love God, because we love our neighbor, because we want our neighbor to flourish. We want to be fully alive in God's presence. And in doing so, we flourish with them because we are being served as we are serving others. So, human evil, the hope here is that a virtuous person can develop a very high level of virtue, where human evil can be avoided. Can you develop a high level of virtue to the point where, with God's help, with God's grace, with God's divine power helping you, you can avoid mortal sin, murder, theft, things that destroy your relationship with God and neighbor? Sure, people do it all the time. What about venial sin, those things that injure your relationship with God and neighbor? Do we develop a high level of virtue where we avoid those completely? Well, no. There's always room for improvement. But we can grow in this love. We can grow in virtue and do less of this, and more of developing those bonds of love between ourselves and God and our neighbor. And that is good news indeed. Now, natural evil on the next video.